Our last speaker for today, I think, is Dr. Glenda Mejia. Okay.
And Trini.
Oh, of course, Trini Espinosa Abasco.
Yeah, so we've been learning.
Okay, people, welcome.
We're going to do a presentation. Okay. First, I want to thank you, Kat, for inviting us, especially when our topic has to do with a very different group of, you know, Latin Americans. So we're going to move away from China and Japan and Singapore. But I hope you enjoy this talk. Trini and I, we are kind of new in this area. But we also want to know how the Latin American community here in Australia, because it's not very well known and it's very small, uses social media. In particular, this web page that stories of very successful Latin Americans have performed here in Australia, and how it's linked to Facebook, and how the members see these stories and motivate them. Even though we're using the term Latin American, we're just going to focus on Spanish speakers. We're going to exclude Brazilians because Trini and I don't speak the language to an extent that we can analyze the post. All right. So migrant groups not only create physical networks in the whole society, but also create web pages, blogs, and Facebook linkages that connect them with migrants from other communities and with migrants in other host countries, like the Latin American community. With this particular one, we found that they are connected not only within the Latin Americas here in Australia, but with other continents in Europe, Asia, and the Americas. Some study has shown that the use of social media among migrant groups create connections across oceans within families, friends, and community members, as is being presented here today. Also, some studies have stated that social media engage communities by creating spaces in which migrants can share and express their experiences as migrants, either positive or negative or inspirational, as we found here in this web page, and we're going to talk more about later on. However, some studies also argue that these online spaces allow migrants to only interact within their own community, friends, and families, and this may interfere with the integration in the host society. However, nowadays, people can be lonely and engaged in two or more places at the same time. Consequently, we believe that social media allows migrants to construct translocal and transglobal connections to concepts that have been mentioned before, which at the same time enhance them to adapt and to adopt to the new conditions of the host society. So the focus of our research, which is still in progress, is more focused in the area of migration. So the concept of diaspora, which is also being mentioned, is an old concept and a new concept. And the one we focus is the one that is the migrants not only are forced, like, you know, Jewish, they were forced and they create the diaspora, but also the reasons why they migrate or the cross mobility is completely diverse. These linkages, like using social media, is still in there. So even though they migrate here to the host country, that linkages and that connection is still there. It doesn't refer only to the ethnic and religious groups, but also the communities. They start creating communities of networking, and I'm going to talk more about that later on, of how this Latin American diaspora has created that networking offline and online, and how this group want to integrate, these new migrants wanted to integrate, and to also collaborate and provide social and cultural capital to the host society. My area of research is much to do with migration and belonging. And we agree that, you know, belong, especially Click talks a lot about that. This idea that we just can belong to one place. We believe that we can belong in more than two places, and what we can call home doesn't have to be the country that the origin of what we come from. And people, the members or the participants in this study has shown that they can belong to two cultures or to two places. We focus onto the stages of migration, the pre-migrants, the post-migrants, and the settled migrants. And the pre-migrants are the ones that they're still in the origin country. So we have seen in the Facebook, you know, Mexicans wanted to migrate to Australia, so they want to know how is Australia or what are the process to come here. The post-migrants are the new arrivals, those that have been living in Australia less or in the host country less than 5 years, and they want to know more about how to settle in because some of them found that it's not as smooth or, you know, as you mentioned, that, you know, social imaginary that it's going to be easy. And the settled migrants are those that have lived in the host country more than 5 years, and those are the ones that this particular webpage focus on as well. So, as I said, I'm new to all these social media, but I'm quite interested in and I'm using it on my teaching with my Spanish students. But also, I've been reading these stories in the Latin American website. And so this idea of how these narratives or these stories impact on a migrant already here or the pre-migrant, it was this curiosity, how they impact, how they motivate, how can that help to settle or to integrate, or the process of integration can be a bit smooth and easier, if we want to use that word. And now Trini is going to talk about, so you have an idea of the Latin American community here in Australia.
Thanks. Well, Latin American migration in Australia is believed that it has been, the literature say there are two waves, but we're suggesting a third wave. So the first wave came was in the late 1960s, and it was mainly people from Chile, Uruguay, and Argentina. And they came because there was financial and political instabilities in their country, so there was a good way to come to Australia. The second wave was between 1980s and 1990s, and it was people mainly from Central America, because at that time there was civil war and political turmoil in the country, so they were escaping from that. And we're proposing a third wave of Latin Americans that started in 1990s until now, and it's people mainly from Colombia, Mexico, Venezuela, and Ecuador. And these people is pretty much, they're coming as skilled migrants, or because they're marrying in Australia. These young professionals, they're coming as young professionals or international students, and the characteristics is that people is very well educated, they are young, and at least 80% try to get a citizenship to stay in Australia. So it's very different to the previous two waves. So that was just a bit of context of Latin Americans, but now I just want to talk to you about this website and how it's linked with Facebook. So Latino Stories Australia is a website that was started by two Mexican immigrants, females, 2 years ago, and the idea is to emphasize inspirational role models of Latin Americans settled in Australia. This with the objective to inspire other immigrants that want to come or they are struggling to settle in Australia, but also to highlight the contribution that Latin Americans are doing for Australia, and as a way to emphasize ethnic success stories separate to the ones that are very stereotyped, what people think about Latin Americans. So this is how the website looks like. For example, Telmo Langilier is the speaker of the lower house. He came from Uruguay, escaping. He was shot when he was 18 years old by the police, so he was kind of escaping from that. And what the stories mainly focus is like a small summary of the participant, and then They tell their story, the motivation to come to Australia, what has been their journey as an immigrant in this country. Then it focuses on the challenges, that they have encountered to settle and how they overcome them. And then contrast between Latin America and Australia. And again, it could be similar to what you were mentioning. Then they give a piece of advice for new immigrants or for people that are struggling to settle. And finally, they just said, what are the future projects? So we didn't focus our research on this website, but we focus our of the uses of, so this website has their own Facebook page, and we focus on the users of those that Facebook page. So the website page on Facebook has more than 2,000 followers so far, and the post reach gets around 10K per month. And the majority of participants are female, between 25 and 45 years old. Sorry, yeah. So in order for them to get that post reach, what they are doing is also they are trying to integrate their Facebook page with other Facebook pages that are related to Latin America. And we can see there are a lot of Facebook pages. The majority of them are focused on a specific country. So what they want to do is kind of bring together all the countries and showing stories of different nationalities of Latinos with different ages and professions. So they want to show what Latinos are doing here in Australia. So our methodology, so we use the messages that were posted in this page, and we identified that there were five main themes. So they were posts regarding identity and belonging, cultural codes, challenges as migrants, experiences of the Australian culture, and motivations to adapt or adopt ways of living in Australia. So that was the first stage. And then in order to create more discussion about it, we posted five questions regarding each of these themes. And in total, we analyzed 63 messages that were content analyzed. And now Glenda is going to tell you a little bit about the results.
So by analyzing their views as migrants and the motivation of the Latin American stories, we then group responses onto the three phases of migration, the pre-migrant, post-migrant, and settled migrant. And the objective of using these three terms was to explore the intersection between networks of those who have migrated, those who have integrated, and those who have intended to migrate and are in any other diaspora space or place. And as Levity and Click, they say this intersection, and I quote, allows a comparison between experiences of migrants and those who are only indirectly influenced by ideas, objects, and information flowing across online borders, end of quote. So then we went into analyzing using content analysis, and we found that the group of pre-migrants use the Facebook just to find out more about being curious of how life is here in Australia, what the difference would be between Australia and the United States, because most of these pre-migrants that want to immigrate, they have already lived in the United States or they have lived in Europe. So the questions were not really much to do, like how hard it is to live in Australia, but it's like, what is it, how it is? Because the idea also that, or this image that they have about Australia is sunny and it is, you know, very full of nature. And how Australians behave or what they like or how is the society. Some of the questions that they mainly ask is the cost of living. So they want to know, you know, how is the exchange? If the scholarship that they got or the job, because most of these pre-migrants or the migrants that want to come to Australia, they already have a profession or they already speak English, so there's not an issue for them. Renting a house, how is the process, how much does it cost, and schools and transport, because most of them are young professional with kids that they want to know how this schooling is here in Australia. The pause in settled migrants, it was a common thing that they feel a lot of empathy when they were reading these stories, because they have gone through that process of migration and challenges. They have also talked about the experiences of two cultures, because the majority of the stories, the successful stories, talk about accepting both cultures, and after living here for a long time, it's all right to integrate and to live both, to embrace both cultures. The Latin stories, Australia, they found it, and it was common to say that they found like a network or a place of belonging where they can discuss feelings or emotions about the experiences of migrating or how hard it is to settle in. And it was a lot of pride because the stereotype of Latin Americans, especially in the United States, is very negative. So by them reading these stories that Latin Americans have actually contributed to the economy and society of Australia, and that they are professionals, it was really rewarding and encouraged to, you know, go and say, oh, I can be that as well. So it was a lot of pride on that. Oops. Yeah. So this is an example of the empathy. They know how hard it is to come to a new country, to leave your family, your culture, your language. But it is part of the process, and it's all right. And that is another type or a different cycle of life that we all have to go through that. This was a post-migrant and a newly arrival. This participant has said that, well, if, you know, God has to punish me because I love two cultures, he's a very passionate Latino saying, yeah. So it is all right. It is all right to be integrated and accept. And the majority of the members on Facebook and also the Latin American stories have consistently have said that it is okay to be integrated. So that idea when Malcolm said, you know, it's gonna be really hard for Central Americans to adapt because we're so different, is really weak argument, because we have not this, just this, but data that shows that we have integrated really well in Australian society. So this place is a place of belonging when they have found an inspiration and motivation, and also they want to contribute. When they see that what they have done, not just contribution to the Australian society, but also to the Latin American community, they want to be part of that as well. And some of them have found that it has kind of switched the idea of, oh my God, this is so hard, you know, I can actually achieve more that I can, that I want. And they found that as a support group as well. So this is just how it has inspired this person and wants to be part of it and take it as like a mentoring way of, I can do it as well. Okay, just very quick. We like this one because this person shows a lot of what it means when that reads this story. If he wakes emotions, all type of emotions, and also feels that he has found a group where, you know, he feels that he belongs, and also hopes that that is doing the same thing for all the Latin American migrants as well. This is an example of someone that is really proud to be Latino and to see what other Latin Americans are doing, because when this person arrived 13 years ago, the idea of, oh, we Latinos, therefore the only thing we can do is doing cleaning, or if we go to uni, we're never gonna be able to achieve a H1 So this story has kind of changed this view of what a Latino means or what you can be as a Latino and how much you can actually do. So probably, as he mentioned, it's not just he already have a job and probably found it hard to achieve that, but it's transmitting that motivation to the new generation, to the children. Okay, so just very quick to conclude. Yeah, okay, very quick. So we consider migrants from Latin American countries as an example of a new and transnational digital diaspora in Australia who are not only actively involved online but offline by sharing their social capital within the whole society. The argument that those migrants who are involved on online groups may huddle the process of settlement and involvement in the real community is not supported by the references of these participants in this study who have clearly indicated their success and their contribution to the Australian society. Many of them in areas different from the ones they used to do back home, but that they were well received here in Australia. Many of those members have clearly stated that they sustain a respect and interest in both countries, Australia and their origin country, and that this does not burden to integrate and be part of a new way of living. It is clear that social media, such as Facebook, webpage link, is not only used to obtain information, but also to maintain social contacts and a sense of community, a place or a space in which discussions of feeling at home can openly be discussed and starting feeling or claim I belong. The results of this study have demonstrated that Facebook is a space that provides the opportunity to create new connections while maintaining a common identity based on similarities of culture, language, and migrant stories. That what links pre, post, and settled migrants in Australia is to discover a commonly experience of migration in what those pre-migrants are about to embark. The participants of this study, like the participants found in another study similar to migration and social media, indicate the diasporic online community provides a sense of solidarity and a space in which they can share common challenges as migrants to new land, to a new culture, and to new ways of living. This leaves us an open discussion that belong to a place may not only be physical, but virtual, in which a space migrants come together and start creating emotional ties and even a community of identities and identity and identities. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I realize it's been a long day. Just stay with us, it's the last panel. Any questions for Glenda and Trini, please? I have a question. I was looking at the website and I noticed it was all written in English. And I was wondering if there's a Latin or Spanish version or, you know.
So it's written in English because they want to show what Latinos are doing in Australia. So that's why they don't want to focus only on the Latino community. And I think they have like a side project and they translate their stories and they are published in Mexico.
But when they publish the post, you know, when they want to give their opinions, they're in Spanish. So the majority will probably use Spanglish or some English, but the majority will be posted in Spanish. And I guess another reason is also that these people that write their own stories, that they're very proud, they have Australian friends, and they want to share it with them so they can actually read it.
So what proportion of the people who follow this Facebook page are Australian English speakers rather than?
So 70% were living in Australia, and around 20% in Latin America. And there were some people in Asia and in Europe as well. So perhaps mainly Latinos, but they were living overseas.
And so the proportion of Anglo or English Australians is very low. If you have a friend and you posted in this friend, what we found too is that these people don't read only that story of the friend, but they continue reading the other stories. Oh. And so this one kind of link to others. Yeah. But it's low portion English speakers reading. Or second generation of Latinos as well.
We found that one girl, she's a second generation of a Chilean family, and what she found is like, kind of motivate her to start learning Spanish as well. So, yeah.
Brenda.
Yes.
This is such a good example of a social media space that's used to create solidarity and common identity amongst, I would imagine, very disparate people coming from different generations of migration, as well as across class and nationalities and so forth. So I'm just wondering whether there's a flip side to this. Are there also virtual spaces where, which are more filled with more tension and more sort of conflict, or is the Latin American kind of space out there always this harmonious?
Yes, yeah. The
compared to Concourse Killing.
Yes. we haven't really explored all the, you know, web pages or linkages where they actually there is an argument or discrepancy. But I doubt it, you know, there will be. The good or the positive thing about this.
I'm asking who controls that space? I mean, in terms of the kinds of stories that are portrayed,
are
very positive stories.
Yeah,
so
Trini mentioned, there was two Mexican women professionals that they interview the participants to write the stories, and so they are the ones that control it and edit and all that, the stories, and they link it to the Facebook page of Latin American Stories, and then the members start linking it with others. But it's these two women that actually have control of that page.
Can I ask the question maybe in a different way? Are there any negative stories on that?
Yeah. Negative stories. No, they're not. No.
So they've been moderated out.
That's right. Okay, yeah. Right. Because the purpose, as Trini said, the purpose or the aim of this web page is just to show the opposite. It's enough stereotype, it's enough negativity out there about Latinos. So why writing about, you know, stories that people already reading in the media? So the idea is to write and to demonstrate something different and positive about Latinos in Australia.
Has your research actually taken you into other areas where there are negative? Are there other websites, alternative websites? Because, you know, whenever something's moderated, someone comes out with, you know, something else for that space. You know, you think of Reddit, you know, that kind of thing. So has anything like that happened? Have you found?
Well, I personally know, but...
Well, just like a personal experience on Facebook, there is, for example, in Venezuela, that with this, what is happening with the president... So there is a specific Facebook page saying, like, Venezuelans in wherever, like a free expression website. So people can be there, can go in there and talk freely, bad or good things, and they're supposed to be, that's supposed to be okay. Because perhaps in other pages, if you start saying bad things, people will be start to, like, to get involved. But also in the website, when they talk about the challenges, they also say a little bit about negativities as well, or what they have encountered that hasn't been positive. Like a guy talked about being as, like when he went to Brisbane, he experienced a lot of racism. So there is, I mean, the idea is to show how they overcome that, but there are negativities in the story as well. So it's not just...
Yeah, is that negative enough to talk about?
I think we're all quite fascinated by this aspect of the topic. Do you think that part of the filtering out and the showing positive stories only is part of a, you know, I mean, we've all done probably different work on the visualization and visibility, social visibility aspects of social media, internet, imagined communities, that sort of thing. Do you think there's a bit of an intergenerational thing going on there in terms of, you put up a quote with a young man saying, it makes me want to do positive things. Do you think that there's a bit of a, let's portray an ideal and then we within the community will then actualize that ideal?
I would say yes, because as I said, also the type of migrants that have arrived here or they're arriving right now, they're young professionals. So. And it's interesting that I have, apart from this study, that I have interviewed Mexicans, and they have not say we're migrating here because of, you know, the cartels or what's going on in Mexico. It's just they want to have an adventure. They want a different job. They have left jobs, really, you know, very strong jobs in the United States, in Chicago City, but they just, you know, they just want to experience Australia, which I was expecting for them to tell me, oh, we're running away from, you know, the cartels and all that. So I guess the Mexicans that have created, they also want to give this positive of, yeah, we know the cohort of Latinos in Australia is very different from the one from the United States, which is the one that most people have. And the ways of migrating are completely different. To migrate from Mexico to Australia illegally would be possible, but really hard. Yeah, so.
One last question.
Okay. So I'm so greedy. I keep asking questions. this is fascinating paper. I'm just interested in your identification of the third wave of migrants. And as you say, they seem to be a very different type of migrant, like a more middle class kind of cosmopolitan orientation, rather than a, you know, fleeing from political and other kinds of violence. I'm just wondering, and this is kind of just informational, but within the community, are there views of one wave of migrants about the other waves? Because I'm thinking about my observations of different waves of Chinese migrants. There is tension between the waves sometimes.
I don't think it's much tension, because the ones that migrate, and the way, and an example, the way I migrate here as a refugee, it was very different from now the refugees migrating here or the illegals that are migrating in the United States. So we integrate so well that we have the new ones, that we interact with them really well. And they see us as an example that it is easy, or not easy, but you can integrate the same way. So there is not tension, or this is you know, Chilean, or even though Latin American countries, we speak the same language, we have differences as well. But it's a lot of solidarity. When something is going on, you know, people participate. And this is an example of a web page that is just not, it was created by Mexicans, but it's not just Mexicans. It's people from Venezuela, Argentina, different backgrounds. So it's not much tension as I have read, for example, Polish in UK, you know, the new generation and the old, and how there is tension between them, but not really. They always said, oh, I have a friend from El Salvador, which is Central America, and, you know, I like to hang out with them and all that, the new early arrivals. So not yet that I have observed or that I have explored, but so far this, no, yeah.
Okay, everyone.